Welcome to the session on open statements. Open statements are declarative sentences with variables. For example, x plus 3 equal to 6. Here x is the variable, that's why it's an open statement. Its value can be any number. X divides 4. Here again we have x as a variable, so it is an open statement. Now open statement with one variable, they are usually denoted like p of x, r of x, q of x. So previously in laws of logic, rules of inference, in our previous classes we have known that normal propositions are normally written as p, q, r. So here it was directly proposition. Here in open statements, so these are propositions with a variable, that's why they are written as p of x, q of x, r of x. So these x may take some values, some numerical values. So suppose if the variable is replaced by value say a, then p of x become p of a. So in other words, suppose we will take x equal to 5. Okay, so value a denotes here that some specific value. So suppose if we take x equal to 4, then p of x becomes p of 4. Suppose the universal set consists of all integers. Set here is integer. So consider the open statement. P of x is x is less than or equal to 3. Q of x plus 1 is odd. R of x, the statement says x is greater than 0. So write the truth values of the statements. Okay, so we'll see. P of 2 here x will be equal to 2. So what here it becomes a 2 is less than or equal to 3. So it is true. So the truth value of this statement is true. Next, negation of q of 4. So q is x plus 1 is odd. X plus 1 is odd. So 4 plus 1 is odd, 5 is odd, which is true. So we have negation of q of 4. Q of 4's logical value is true. Negation in q of 4's logical value will be false. Next we will have P of 1, so biconditional negation of Q of 2. Okay, so let's see. P of 1 is less than or equal to 3, biconditional negation of Q of, that is a Q of, we have Q of 2. 2 plus 1 is odd. So whether it is true, let's see. 1 is less than or equal to 3, which is true. 2 plus 1, that is 3, is odd. Again, true. So remember our truth table of biconditional. In biconditional, so 1 biconditional 1 is 1, that is true. Okay. So the truth value of the biconditional is true. Now we come to our next topic, known as quantifiers. Now what are quantifiers? We quantify things. So 2, 3, 4, these are all quantifiers. Now the quantifier which is relevant to this topic is two terms. Those are for all and for some. So let me give you an example. All squares are rectangles. Okay, all. So you take a squares, they can be all squares are rectangle. All are. So this is all quantifier. It applies to each and every item of the set. Now some determinants are equal to zero. So there are many determinants, but some are equal to zero. So in a set, there are many determinants. We have a set of determinants. In there, some of the determinants are zero. So how to express that? So suppose for all x belongs to S, here x, there is a set S. Okay, so you take some object x which belongs to S. So that's the meaning. So here, for all x belongs to S means every variable, every x, every item you take from S. Okay, so x is a rectangle where S is a universe of rectangles. Okay, how do we write that? Every x, for all every x, you can take, for every object which you take from set S. Okay, so they are rectangles P of x. Okay, so you take P of R, it is a rectangle. U of PR, R1 rectangle, square 2, it's a rectangle. You take a square 3, it is a rectangle. You take square N, it is a rectangle, like that. Okay, so other words for all quantifier is for every square is a rectangle. For any, so you have a set, you take any of the squares, it is a rectangle. For each, you have a set, for each of the item of that square, set of squares, it is a rectangle, that is a rectangle. So these are all for every, for all, for any, for each, these are called universal quantifiers. Okay, so these are called universal quantifiers. Next we will take an example for sum. So we have a set of polygons, we have a set of polygons. In that polygon, some are rectangle, not all are rectangle. Okay, some are rectangle. How do we write that? So we have a set S. There are some items in X, some S which belongs to S, such that they are polygons. Okay, so you take X1 polygon. Okay, may be polygon, may not be polygon. X2 may be rectangle, may not be rectangle. X3 may be rectangle, may not be rectangle. Okay, so X1, X2, X3. So our S is a set of here in this example. So all are polygons we have. All are polygons. Only X2 and X4 are rectangles. So if that is the case, then how do we write? Okay, so there are some items X, there are some polygons X which belongs to set S, such that they are rectangles. They are rectangles for some. So for some quantifier, so there are other names also, there exists. So in a set of polygons, there exists some X such that they are rectangle. At least, so in a set of polygons, there are at least one polygon which is a rectangle. So these are called existential quantifiers. These say there exist. Let's take some examples for universe of integers. Universe, okay, so it belongs to all integers. So P of x, the statement says x is greater than 0. Q of x, statement says x is even. R of x states x is a perfect square. S of x says x is divisible by 3. T of x is divisible by 7. So with all these statements we have, so you write the quantified statements in symbolic form. So they are given in sentences, we have to write them in symbolic form. Let's see one by one. At least one integer is even. Okay, so x is even, so q of x. So at least one means sum. So there are many integers, so at least some are even. At least one is even. Okay, the for sum, yeah, q of x. That's how it comes like that. Every integer is either even or odd. Either even or odd. Q of x says x is an even integer. So every integer, so for all x, they are such that either even or odd. So it is an XOR condition. So either they are even, integer even, or they are negation of Q of x. Q of x are exclusive or negation of Q of x. So let's take a third one. If x is even and a perfect square, then x is not divisible by 3. So if x is even and a perfect square, then x is not divisible by 3. So we have to just observe here the conditional statement whenever it comes. So it always is for all x. Okay, for all x. Now x is even, we know that it is Q of x, and so we have an and symbol here. A perfect square. So what is the symbol here? X is a perfect square, R of x. So we will write here R of x. Then it is x is not divisible by 3. So S of x is divisible by 3. X is not divisible by 3. So we will have a negation S of x. So this will be the answer. So these are the symbolic representation of the sentences given. So we look at it, some two rules of inference, two conclusions from quantifier's point of view. So in an open statement P of x, where x belongs to some universe S, so if some object A belongs to S, then P of A is true. So what are we saying here? So if P of X, some statement is true for every object of the universe, if every object of the set, then if you take a single object from the set, then the statement is still true. Suppose we have every square is a rectangle, take that statement. So we have 10 squares. So if we have that every square is a rectangle, then the fourth square is a rectangle. Okay, if you take P of a fourth square, okay, so S4, then also is a rectangle. So for a given statement, if it is true for every object or item of the set, then it is true for the single object or item which is taken for that set. Okay, so this is to conclude how to assign truth statement. So this is called rule of universal specification. So you are specifying here S4, that's why it called specification. Okay, you are here specification P of A, some item A which belongs to set S, you are specifying here, that's why it called rule of universal specification. So let's take the second rule. So if an open statement P of X is true for any arbitrary X chosen from a set S, then quantified statement for all X belongs to S, P of X is true. This is called rule of universal generalization. What is this telling? So if P of X is true for any arbitrary X, okay, so you have a set of 10 squares, you choose any of the square, it is a rectangle. That means that it is for all symbol, okay, for every object, for every square of the set, it is a rectangle. So for if we have an open statement is true for any object which is taken from the set, then we write for all x, for all item which are present, the statement, given statement is true. This is known as a rule of universal generalization. So here rule of universal specification, here rule of universal generalization, both are saying the same thing. Why two different terms? So here at the beginning we are assuming that it is true it is true for every item of the set, then it is true for a single item of the set. Here we are taking, so if it is true for any single item, any is the main part here, for any single item we have taken from the set, then it is true for every item of the set. Okay, so if we are telling, suppose we have 10 mangoes, if we are doing a shopping and we have 10 mangoes to choose, the shopkeeper says, choose any mangoes you want, they are good. That means that he is telling every mango is good. Every mango in my shop is good. So that is the second statement. Rule of universal generalization. So you pick any of the objects, they are any of the mangoes, they are good. So every mango in my shop is good. So he is generalizing. The shopkeeper is generalizing. That's why these are the two rules of inference which we have to remember. Now we look at some rules or logical equivalence. Okay. So if you have for all x, p of x and q of x. Okay. So then if you apply that for all x to each of the statements p of x and q of x, still they will be logically equivalent. So suppose if you have for all x p of x and q of x, then you can easily conclude or replace it with, you can independently apply it to each of the open statements, each of the open statements. That's first one. Second one, for some x, p of x or q of x. So if they are logical, so for if there is or, you can independently apply for some. If it is and, you can independently apply for all. Okay. So if you have for all x, p of x or q of x, then it can be logically written as for some x p of x or for some x q of x. You can independently apply them. Okay. So let's go to the third one. For some x p of x conditional q of x. If you have something like that, then how to write logical equivalence for some x? Okay. So p of x or q of x, you can write like this. So you can remember that there is one result which we used in our previous classes. P conditional q will be logically equivalent to negation p or q, right? So same thing is used here. So negation, so p conditional q is logically equivalent to, so all laws of logic and rules of inference which we have learned in the previous class holds for open statements involving quantifiers. So the same rules of p becomes p of x, and some rules are there regarding for some and for all. If we follow that one, so we are again repeating the concepts of laws of logic and rules of inference. So some rules are there how to change for some and for all when a negation appears. So if you negate for all x, so it becomes for some x. If you negate for some x, they become for all x. So apart from the p of x become negation p of x again here. Okay, this does not change. It's a normal operation which we know. So here what we have to observe is, if we have if we apply for all x the negation, then it becomes for some. For some becomes for all. So next, so for a universe of integers, so we have a set of statements, x is positive, x is even, x is a perfect square, x is divisible by 3, x is 7. So we have to express this symbolic statement. Some symbolic statements are given, so we have to express them in sentences, and also we have to provide a truth values for them. So let's see first one, for all x, for any integer x, for all x. Okay, so if r then p, We have something like this. So let's say for any integer x, for all x also we can write, not a problem. Any integer x, for every integer x, so we have different statements. So if it's a conditional, so if what is r of x, x is a perfect square, if x is a perfect square, then what is p of x, x is greater than 0. So it is telling that every integer which is a perfect square, okay, any integer is a perfect square, then it is positive, it is false, because a 0 is there, so in that case it is false. So if x is a perfect square, then it is a positive. Next one, there are for some x, s of x and negation of q of x, for some integer x, so or there exists some integer x, what is s of x? S of x is divisible by 3, so x is divisible by 3, and q of x is x is even, so we can tell it x is not even. So there are some integers which are divisible by 3 and they are not even. Take an example of 15. So this one is true. Next, for all x, every integer x, for any integer x, so x is a perfect square, r of x is a perfect square, we have a negation here. X is not a perfect square. If we take the truth value of x, so every integer is not a perfect square. That's what it's telling. That is wrong, because we have 4, 9, 16, something like this. So it is wrong, false. Next one is all the integer, for every integer, x is a perfect square or x is divisible by 7, is false again. So r of x is a perfect square. Next, t of x is divisible by 7. So for every integer, either it is a perfect square or it is divisible by 7. So it is wrong. So we can take an example of 5. So it is neither a perfect square nor divisible by 7. So this is false. So let's consider some open statements. So p of x equal to this is absolute value, okay, of x. Suppose you have in for this example minus 4, the absolute value becomes 4. Okay, negative number will be considered as a positive number. So p of x is greater than 3. Okay, so let's see. Find the truth value of the statement. Also write their converse, inverse and contra positives. So that's what you have to write. Okay, so let's see. For all x, p of x conditional, q of x, maybe you need a refresher on what are converse, inverse and contra positives. So if conditional you have, so the inverse, so complicated, converse will be q conditional p, inverse will be this one, contra positive will be, okay, so this will be converse, this will be, if you add negation to both statements, it becomes inverse, and the other one becomes the contra positive. Okay, so with that we'll take this whether this is true. So suppose if the absolute value is true, then the number is also true. So take a negative number, 4 we have taken, this is 3, then minus 4 is greater than 3, this is wrong. Okay, so here when we take absolute value, if this is true, then this is wrong, minus 4 is greater than 3, this is false. Okay, so the truth value of the given statement is false. Okay, so let's take the next one. Okay, so q of x, p of x. So suppose you take we have a wrong example here, so we'll take a right example. So we'll take some 5. So let's consider x equal to 5. So then what happens? Q of x for q of x is 5 greater than 3, then absolute value of 5 is also greater than 3. That is true. Okay, so if the number, the real number is greater than 3, then its absolute value also is greater than 3. So sign does not change. So this is true. So the converse is true when we take x equal to 5. Take the example x equal to 5 for the second one. So I want to communicate here that a statement, for example, P conditional Q is logically equivalent to its contrapositive, that is negation Q conditional negation P. Okay, and an inverse and converse both are logically equivalent. Okay, the statements and its contrapositive are logically equivalent. The inverse of the statement, the inverse of the converse of the statement, they are logically equivalent. Okay, so now we have proved that the statement is false, then its contrapositive is also false. You can straight away write that one. So we have proved by taking x equal to 5, okay, we have taken x equal to 5, that this converse is true, so its inverse should also be true because these two are always logically equivalent. Okay, so these are the truth values of the given statement and also the converse, inverse and contrapositive. So some statements are given and we are going to find the negation of the statements. So these answers are scratched because just to do the problem ourselves and not to know the answers prior. Okay, so we'll just do the problems by ourselves. So for some x, the P of x or Q of x you have. So let's apply the negation. So we are applying negation because the question asks us to do for some x becomes for all x. Okay, so and apart from that, so apply for P of x or Q of x the negation. So here we use a De Morgan law. So we using P of x and negation of Q of x, this will be the answer. So this is the answer for the first one. So let's do the for the second one. Okay, so next will be for all x P of x and negation of Q of x. So also an easy one. Okay, so we have negation of x P of x and negation of Q of x. So apply negation to the whole statement, so you will get for some x negation of P of x and negation of Q of x. So apply the negation, apply De Morgan law, negation of P of x and Q of x. You have and, there was and, so you will be having or. So next law of double negation we will use and we will have our negation of P of x or Q of x. This will be the answer. So let's go to next one. So we have a conditional here, so we have to remember so how a conditional works. A P conditional Q, so if there is a negation, then it is P and negation Q. Okay, so this is the rules. So we for some, we'll do it directly here. So we have for all, it becomes for some x for some x. So what does negation does here? P of x and negation q of x. Okay, this will be the answer. Observe similarity. Okay, so we'll go for the next problem. So here also we see there is a conditional here. Okay, so for all x, if you have p of x or q of x, conditional r of x. So let's apply same thing here for some x, p of x or q of x and negation of r of x. This will be the answer. For all integers, if n is not divisible by 2, then n is odd. Write in symbolic form and find the negation. Okay, let's write in symbolic form. So this is the sense, n is not divisible by 2. So we have a not here. So n is divisible by 2 will be a proposition. Along with that, n is odd. Okay, so we have two of them. So that's what we have written is P of n, n is divisible by 2, q of n, pq we have taken, n is odd. So how to write for all integers, for all n which belongs to z, you can, because here n is there, we are taking, you can take x also if it was x there. Okay, so for all n, for all integers which belongs to, the universe of integers, so then, so the, if n is not divisible, we are putting, if there is no negation, then n is divisible by 2. So negation we are having here, if n is not divisible by 2, then n is odd. So this will be the statement we have. And if we have a negation, so what will we get here? We'll just see. For all n becomes for some. Okay, so for some n which belongs to integers, so we know what happens to the statement when we apply a negation to the conditional. So we'll directly apply that one. So p of n and negation q of n is what you have get. So we are using the logic. That's what we are doing here. Negation p remains as it is because it was in the primary statement, and negation q of n. So if we convert this into sentence form again, so for all became for some integer n, so negation p of n is not divisible by 2, and we have, and n is not odd. So here q of n was n is odd. Negation of q of n is not odd. So this question is also similar to previous question. If k, m, n are any integers where k minus m and m minus n are odd, then k minus n is even. So how can we write this one? So I said this, if there is a conditional, it will be a for all symbol. So for all k comma n, okay, so which belongs to integer, okay, so then so if k minus m is odd, so if k minus m is odd, can take it as p of x. If k minus m is odd, p of x, and m minus n is odd, q of x. Okay, then k minus n is even, we can take it as r of x. Okay, so that's how we can write p of x is k minus m is r, q of x is m minus n is r, and then r of x is k minus n is even. We have directly written here. So if we want to write the take the negation, so straight away we can write, how can we write this one? For sum, there are sum n which belongs to integer, okay, such that p of x and q of x and negation of r of x. Okay, negation of r of x. So what does this become when we see it in center? There exists, or for some k, for some k comma n comma n, you can write like that. Okay, so there exist, or for some k comma n, which are who are integers, okay, such that k minus m and m minus n are odd, and k minus n is not even. Okay, so the negation went here. Okay, r of x was k minus n is even, so that becomes k minus n is not even. So what changed? For all became for some, or here there exist, for all became for some, and here the negation was there, that's why k minus n is not even. So that's how it worked here.